Well, I hope you've had a wonderful week. We're glad you're joining in with us this morning for our service. So if you would, bring your homes, please join us as we sing the song, There is Power in the Blood, and Are You Washed in Blood? Through the blood of Jesus, through the sacrifice that he made for us.
that is how we have our freedom. But we want to remember that for our country, we live in a country that's not perfect. And we have faults just like everywhere else. But God has really blessed us tremendously. From where we live, the fact that we may be struggling with not being able to be in person in church this morning, but we can have some kind of church. We're not having to go underground with it. We're allowed to do that in the country where we live in. God has blessed us. So just remember the blessings we have too. We are tremendously blessed, but it is because of how people fought for it. Fought for the freedom we didn't have, and people made sacrifices for us. So this is just some things to think about this week, and we are excited about next week. We've been, I keep saying we as a church have been working for a while with the guys that have been working really hard to make this happen, so we're excited about it. It may not be exactly what we want, but it's we'll get to see each other, and we'll actually be in the church parking lot and stuff together. So just be praying for that. Pray for good weather, too, to make sure we have good weather to make that possible. But what we're going to read this morning is going to be in John chapter 21. So if you're able to, if you will, stand with me. We're just going to read a few verses here, and we're going to kind of backtrack a little bit after we read these verses. But in John 21, 15 through 19, 15 through 19, it says, "When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?' And he said to them, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' And he said to him, 'Feed my lambs.' He said to him a second time, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' And he said to him, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' And he said to him, 'Tend my sheep.' And he said to him a third time, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' Peter was grieved because he said to him a third time, 'Do you love me?' And he said to him, 'Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you.' And Jesus said to him, 'Feed my sheep. Truly, truly, I say to you that when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. When you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go.' This was to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him, 'Follow me.'" You may be seated. But in John chapter 1, we see what I call Peter is being reinstated. So Peter's reinstated into his place that God is really going to use him. And the reason he has to be reinstated, that I kind of look at it that way, is because Peter had messed up. He messed up big time. Peter was bold enough to understand who Christ was. There was a time we see in Scripture that Jesus asked the disciples, he said, "Well, who do people say that I am? Who does everybody else say that I am?" And they named off some of the old prophets and but none of them really said Son of God. That wasn't the answer that anyone of them had. And he said, "Well, who do you say that I am?" And so one of the things I always liked about Peter is Peter was very bold. He was bold enough to say what was on his mind. I don't know about you, but I always like people that are bold enough to say what's on their mind, because you never have to wonder. They just say it. It's there. I always laugh that my grandparents on my Arnold side is you never had to wonder if they liked you, if they liked what you did, because they told you. It was just right out there. They were really bold in that. And I always said, the older I get, that's one of the things I get more excited about, is with age, you can be bold like that, and it's just accepted. So I'm really excited about getting older so I can just say whatever I want. Anyways, sorry, that's probably bad. I probably shouldn't say that at all. But anyways, Peter was bold. He was very bold, and he answered. He said, you're the Messiah. You're the Son of God. You're the Savior. You're the one that these prophets that they said that you were. You're not them. You're the one they were talking about. But then after that, Jesus started telling his disciples what was going to happen to him. He's like, "I'm going to die. I'm going to be crucified. But I'm going to come back." So as he's trying to explain to his disciples that he was going to die, but he was going to resurrect, they didn't really understand it. And Peter says, they'll do it over my dead body, basically. I'll defend you. And he actually kind of backed it up. Because you read in the Garden of Gethsemane, when they did try to come and take Jesus, Peter cut a soldier's ear off. Jesus put the ear back on, another one of his miracles. But he actually backed up what he said he was going to do. Because when he cut the guy's ear off, he missed. He was going to kill him. That's kind of my personal opinion. I kind of have to read into that a little bit to get that. But that's kind of what I think he was going to do. He was actually going to back it up. And then Jesus said, "That's not me. know, if you live by the sword, you're going to die by the sword. That's not how we live. I'm calling you to something different. We're going to be different from the rest of this world. So Peter was probably pretty confused, but then it becomes the time where, it becomes really stressful. It becomes a time where if you're going to make a stand, it's going to mean something, that you're going to have to sacrifice if you're going to really make a stand for Christ. We're going to flip over to Luke chapter 22. In verses 54 to 62 of Luke 22, in verse 54, it says, "Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him to the high priest's house. And Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him as he sat in the light, looked closely at him and said, 'This man also was with him.' But he denied it, saying, 'Woman, I do not know him.' But a little later, someone else saw him and said, 'You are also one of them.' But Peter said, 'Man, I am not.' And after an interval of about an hour, still another insisted, saying, 'Certainly this man was with him, for he too was a Galilean.' But Peter said, 'Man, I do not know. Man, I do not know what you are talking about.' And immediately, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the saying of the Lord, as he had said to him, 'Before the rooster crows today, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and he wept bitterly." So Jesus, at this point, when we read in John chapter 21, Jesus is resurrected. It's before he ascended back into heaven, before what we call Pentecost, when the Holy Ghost comes, and we have a Holy Ghost or a Holy Spirit available to all of us. So there was a great miracle that Jesus had just performed with this great catch of fish. It's the second time he did. You know, the first time was when he called them to be disciples, and now we're showing the same miracle again. They went and caught all this fish, they cooked the fish, they ate breakfast, they're sitting around talking, and then Peter and Jesus start having this conversation. But the same thing is that we look and we see that Jesus asked Peter the very same question 3 times. Do you love me? And one of the times he said, "Do you love me more than these?" But he asked basically the same question 3 times. Because how many times did Peter deny Jesus? 3 times. He was showing him the forgiveness that he was offering, the forgiveness that had happened on the cross, the forgiveness that we're all offering, the sacrifice that offers that to us. And with forgiveness comes freedom. Now, that's why I think that principle is tied into what we remember here before Memorial Day weekend. We can see this principle even in a bigger manner. Because the people that sacrifice for our country. And there were times where sacrifice for our country was bigger because we had joined with other countries to fight off a greater evil. But this was a sacrifice for the world, for all of us. It's how monumental what Jesus did for us. But here's what's interesting to me. I heard one time, I was listening to somebody talk, somebody speak about the disciples. There was one time the disciples were arguing over who was the greatest disciple, and we're on this road, and Jesus was in front of them. And what I keep thinking about is when we went on family vacation, and me and my brother and my sister in the back of a car, and how irritating we must have been to my parents, because we're always picking each other. We're always incidenting something, and my wife Deborah can tell you, I love picking people, and I love getting riled up just to kind of see what reaction I can get just for fun. My dog Chloe, she can talk, probably tell you the same thing. But so I was probably incidenting a lot more than I should have been, but we kept something going on, and I can see how irritated my parents would be by that now that I'm a little older. But I can also see how Jesus probably felt like that too. The kids in the back fussing, and they're fussing about stupid stuff, it doesn't really matter. So Jesus was probably really irritated. But anyways, it mentions 3 times that they were arguing over who was the greatest disciple, basically. Who was the greatest among them. And of course, you probably can imagine they were listing their accomplishments, what they'd done, and the stands they'd made for Jesus, some kind of miracle or they performed, or, it's kind of crazy when you think about Christianity, which requires us to be humble, we'll argue over who's best. But anyways, they're arguing over 3 times. And as Pastor said, when you argue or when you see something mentioned 3 times in Scripture, it's probably continual. Not just that it's literally 3 times. It's a continual thing. Now here's what I get from it when I think about that. 3 times that Peter's denied Christ. And 3 times Jesus asked this question, "Do you love me?" That forgiveness that we've offered from Christ is continual. Because there's more times that we deny Christ ever said, I'm not a Christian, or I don't believe in God. I don't think I've ever audibly said that. But there are times my actions reveal that. Because if I do say that I believe in Christ, the way I live should reflect it.
That's right.
So just like Peter denied Christ, I have denied Christ, even though I've never said it out loud. I've been angry at him before, and I told him one time, years and years ago, I was angry because of things in life weren't working out how I wanted to be, and I said, I don't want to believe in you. I couldn't even stomach myself to say I don't believe in you. Even though what I said was horrible, and the fact that he didn't strike me down right there shows how good he is, and how much he loves, and how much he is willing to forgive. Like, it hurts me even to say that I said that. But we know that our God, that we deny him all the time on the way we act. When we don't react in an image of our Creator. We don't live in that way. So one of the things that kind of made me think about this too is Jesus, he offers the forgiveness this world needs. Because one of the things that we can all say before we knew Christ, obviously we're a sinner. We need to save. But after we know Christ, the more we learn about him, the more we think we find out our heart really is, right? We start to see our actions for who they truly are. The more I've studied about Christ, the more I've studied, I think theology is important because understanding who God is important. We don't need to get so dead set in theology that everybody else is wrong and I'm right. But we need to study and know who God is and the way he works and the things he does because that really understand. We start to understand how good he really is. Start to understand, you know, for what he truly is. Because the more I study about him, the more wrong that I see in me, the more sin I see in my own life, but the more good that I see in him. And I see that good is what I need. And that good is what this world needs. This world's severely broken. It doesn't take long to see it. If you watch the news, however you get it, if you watch it on TV, if you see it from the internet, or however you look at it, most of the time in the news they're going to report the negative because that usually catches the headlines. But you can see how broken this world is because there's a lot of messed up stuff in there. There's a lot of things that are wrong in this world. But we know that Jesus is the light that this world needs. He is what is good. And he shows it here by offering Peter this forgiveness. Now, I want you to think about this. If your very, very best friend, the people that you were counted on most in life, and this is me saying that Jesus thinks like us. He doesn't. He thinks way different. The more you know him, the more you see him. But thinking about it through our eyes and what we see, if my very best friend, the people that I count on the most, in my greatest hour of need, abandoned me, I'd be done with them. I'm not going to forgive them. I'm not going to speak to them anymore. I'm not going to still offer anything. And if I'm in Jesus' position, thinking like I think, that salvation's not offered to them. They had their chance, they blew it. But that's how good God is. He's not as fickle as we are as any humans. Because we can do that to each other, right? We can say, well, you did me wrong, so I'm done with you. And at Jesus' greatest hour of need, the disciple, he was in the garden of Gethsemane praying because he knows this hour is coming. He knows this time is coming. And he's in the garden praying, and the disciples can't even stay awake. And then after they can't stay awake, they don't understand what's going on, that Jesus is willing, he's voluntarily going. He chose to do this, to go and be our sacrifice for us. I know that's what he was sent for, and it was preaching, it was prophesied and all that, I understand that too. But this is what Jesus was doing. He was willingly going. And he was asking even for the strength to do this. Because he was fully God, but he's also fully human. So you get from that point, they have to misunderstand what's going on in the garden. And then from the garden to the crucifixion, we see the disciples maybe following at a distance. And at the actual crucifixion, we only see one disciple mentioned, being on the scene right there. Now, I'm sure the other ones were probably hovering around somewhere. But we also see him after the crucifixion, between the crucifixion and the resurrection, and even after the resurrection, understand why. Because there was a lot of heat on them. There was a lot of pressure on them at this point. But when Jesus appeared to all the disciples, they were in a room with a locked door. When he appeared the second time to the disciples, when Thomas was actually there, we're getting the whole doubting Thomas thing. They were in a room with a locked door, and Jesus came through. So the people that Jesus was closest to here on this earth were running scared, were denying they even knew. There's one part of Scripture I read from you, Luke chapter 22, that's mentioned in the other Gospels too, about Peter's denial. But there's one of the Gospels that even mentions that Peter cursed the last person that asked him about knowing Jesus. Because he was trying to make prove that he didn't know who Jesus was. And if we think about it from a worldly mind, they would dismiss that person. We're done. But if we think about who Jesus is, forgiveness is offered. And if we think about what we do, reflecting on whether or not we truly believe in Christ by the way we live, does Christ continually forgive us?
Amen.
We need to make sure that forgiveness is offered to this world. There was a time that I was listening to a guy named Francis Chan. He told the story. I don't think I'll ever forget it because it was very different than what I remember my childhood being. But anyways, he was telling a story about he wanted his children to understand the love of God. So his daughter came home, and she had made a bad grade on the test, and she's really upset. She finally tells him that she had made this bad grade on her math test. And he said, "What did you study?" And she said, "Yes." She said, "I probably could have studied for it, but I didn't study for it. I failed it. I just didn't do it. I didn't do what I needed to do." So he said, "Well, I want you to sit and think about it for a minute." So he did. He kind of sent her to a room, so to speak, and thinks about it. And a few minutes later, he comes back in and he said, "I tell you what I want you to do. I want you to get yourself cleaned up. We're going to go eat pizza. Then we're going to go to the movies. And then after the movies, we're going to go get ice cream. And I want you to call a few of your friends and tell them that they can come with you." Now, I don't know about you, but when I say this is different from my childhood, I don't ever remember telling my parents that I failed, that I had any kind of a failing grade, and them saying, "We're going to go watch a movie. This is going to be," But he wanted her to understand that even though she had failed, this is the love that God offers us. Because we continue that we cannot get it right. We may have moments we get it right, but we can't live our life right. That's why the law never worked back in the Old Testament. We can't get it right. But the reason we should strive to live in a life that reflects Christ is because we understand how good he is.
Amen.
And we understand what he's done for us. And we understand that the forgiveness that is offered to Christ is continual. Amen. It's not just three times. Three is a very important number in the Bible. But it made me rethink how I think about the number three. It's not Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost is eternal, so it's continual. But it makes me think about the continual forgiveness that Christ offers us. The continual forgiveness that when I think that I've done something well and I'm like one of the disciples that are trying to brag on myself and say, "Look how good I am," that he forgives me because God is good. And the good that I have in me is from him. It's not me. I'm just an idiot that he tends to use. And when I think about how my life and my actions deny my Creator, deny my Savior, that he can continually forgive me. That makes me want to live for him because I know how good he is. And I know what he has done for me. And I want to live a life that reflects him because that's what's best for the world. To understand the forgiveness that only Jesus offers. To understand what we just sang about, the power in the blood, the power in the sacrifice Jesus made for us. And the power that we have to overcome this world through him, that he can overcome it through us. But that's how good he is. So I have some questions I really want us to think about today. One is, what is our response to the same question? Same question here that Jesus is asking us. What if Jesus asks us, "Do you love me? Or do you love me more than this?" What is our response? Next is, are we offering forgiveness to people the way Jesus offers forgiveness to us? Because we're told to forgive in that way. It's hard. When people say Christianity is not hard, there's aspects of it that are really hard. Now, living for Christ is a much more rewarding way than this world can ever offer. That part is easy, living in the blessings. But part of the way we get to the blessings is forgiving people that probably don't deserve it. But I didn't deserve forgiveness either.
Amen.
But it was offered to me. It was offered to you. But are we forgiving people in that same way? And who are we telling about this forgiveness? See, there was a charge that was placed on the end of that question and that answer. Peter was told to either feed my sheep or tend my sheep. He was told to carry on his mission. So when Peter answered correctly, that he understood who Jesus was, that he was the Messiah, that he was the one prophesied about, that he was the Son of God, he was the Savior. Jesus said, you are the rock that I'm going to build the church upon. See, with that charge, Peter left there and started helping build the Christian church. Now, I'm not talking about a building. We're the church.
Amen.
He was a very important part in the building of the church. The same guy who, when they asked if he knew Jesus, was scared to deny him. And I think what I would have done, is if I'd have been charged with the same thing, you know, with going and spreading the gospel, being the rock the church is built upon, if I'm putting myself in Peter's shoes, the moment that I would remember what it was all about, and it would give me courage, even in those times where he would end up having to give his life for sharing the gospel, would be this moment here when Jesus said, do you love me? And my rest of my life would be about showing Jesus that I do. I love you too. I understand that you love me first, but I love you too. And that's why it's so important that we live for Christ. That's how we show we love him. And so that's important why we share that with the people, because that's how we show we love them. Mm-hmm. And that's the two things that God commands us to do. That Jesus himself said, this is what the law is about. Loving God and loving each other.
Amen.
Let's make sure that we do that. We're going to pray. Kind of close out with an instrumental, but I encourage you to think about those questions. What our response is when we offer forgiveness, and are we telling other people about the forgiveness that Christ offers? Father God, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for offering forgiveness to us, that even when our lives deny you, even when our lives don't reflect you, that you still continue to offer us that same forgiveness that you offered Peter here in Scripture. And our Father, help us to be people that are the foundation of what the church is built upon from the beginning. We're continuing to share that. Continuing to share that same gospel so that other people know it. And help us to live in a way that reflects it by offering forgiveness to people that even when we don't think they deserve it. And by living in a way that reflects you, reflects it, the image that we're created in. And we know that you give us the ability to do that through what you've done for us, the sacrifice you made for us. And that Holy Spirit that you placed within us. And now, Father, if there's someone here that's hearing this that doesn't know you, Father, just impress upon their hearts, and this may be the day that they come to know you personally, that they give you your life, that they are saved for all of eternity. And now, Father, just help us to live in such a way that reflects you, not ourselves. We ask these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.